Hello, my name is Dr. Michelle Albert. I am the Vivian Allen Beaumont Endowed Chair of Cardiovascular Medicine at Howard University in Washington, D.C., where I also serve as Chief of Cardiovascular Medicine. I am at the American Heart Association Epidemiology National Meeting being held in San Francisco 2014. The topic of discussion for today is health disparities, history, taxonomy, and opportunities for research. Since 1963, when President Kennedy introduced the Civil Rights Bill, he noted at that moment that, quote unquote, the Negro in America was more disadvantaged than any other group in the United States. Today, that remains true, albeit there are many health disparities across many vulnerable populations. However, the largest disparity in life expectancy, in earning potential, and in education involves the differences between white Americans and black Americans. So what are the causes of these race-ethnic disparities? We've had tremendous advances in therapy, in diagnosis, in identification of causes for cardiovascular disease, death, and risk. However, we've continued to see a gap in life expectancy between whites and blacks. From 1970 to 2010, there has been an improvement in life expectancy according to race ethnicity, such that there's been a 10% improvement in whites and a whopping 17% improvement in blacks. But the gap in the life expectancy still remains. Much of that gap is related to cardiovascular disease. Part of the research that is needed at this particular point in time is the recognition in our research studies that there's a huge non-equivalence of socioeconomic parameters by race and ethnicity that contributes to cardiovascular disease risk. With regards to race-ethnic differences in cardiovascular disease risk and outcome, there are certain challenges that remain that need to be addressed. These challenges include the accelerated aging of blacks compared to whites, the early aggressive onset and progression of disease, the distinctive profile of African-American men, the fact that cardiovascular outcome and risk is often independent of socioeconomic status and is persistent, such that the most advantaged blacks in the United States have poorer outcomes or as poor outcomes as some of the poorest whites in the United States. Another challenge is the academic workforce, scientific workforce in the United States, in that that workforce is very sparse, and there needs to be a pipeline that's built and sustained over time. So these are some of the challenges we face. These challenges are very much tied to the non-equivalence of socioeconomic status by race, ethnicity in the United States. In that, there's a distinctive exposure to socioeconomics and stress, which are intimately tied to each other by race, ethnicity in the United States. Blacks are more likely to be incarcerated, especially young black men. They are more likely to be unemployed. There's a 16.8% rate of unemployment among blacks compared to whites, which is 8.4%. They are more likely to have disordered sleeping patterns, which we know is very much tied to restorative brain activity, which is also tied to the ability to have sound behavior and also to make great decisions related to health and be receptive to adherence related to medications, for example. Other things that are different and very distinctive in the black population compared to other populations include the fact that neighborhoods that blacks live in are very segregated. And per se, the segregation is not the issue as much as the concentration of poverty and adversity related to the segregation that then results in a cycle of decreased access and exposure to environmental toxins. So there are many opportunities for research. The first is, I believe that there needs to be research looking at not only the single, but also cumulative importance of multiple stressors that individuals face by race, ethnicity, and gender. So the intersectionality component is also important, and how they relate to cardiovascular disease risk. Another area of opportunity for research is to understand how racism impacts cardiovascular disease outcome. Both internalized racism and institutionalized racism can result in elevated blood pressure and poor mental and physical health that then in turn result in poor outcomes for many chronic diseases, including cardiovascular disease. So that is another area. A third area is understanding how epigenetics, that is how the patterning of genes based on the social environment varies in contexts where African Americans and Hispanic population reside and live. That is looking at the interaction between gene and environment and how when we develop interventions for cardiovascular disease attenuation, how those factors may need to be infiltrated into our interventions. We also know another area for research opportunity is in the field of implementation. There are recent data that suggest that in a Medicare D population, that folks who are a year out of their myocardial infarction compared to 30 days out of their myocardial infarction were less likely to be adherent to their medications at 1 year compared to at 30 days. And there was a large differential by race, ethnicity, particularly as it related to women, black women, Hispanic women in particular. There was a 30% decrease in the rates of adherence at 1 year post-myocardial infarction. This is quite disturbing because these are actually people who have disease already and have had heart attacks. So developing vectors and a 360 model of care that takes care of patients not only after they leave the when they're in the hospital, but when they're in a community setting where they work, live, and play is really important towards developing a constructive plan to eliminate race-ethnic disparities. Another area of opportunity for research involves the academic workforce. At this point in time, we have a very, very fractured academic scientific pipeline, in part related to early lack of early opportunities for science education in minority communities, in black and Hispanic communities in particular. And then this then perpetuates itself over time, over the life course, such that once these individuals get to the level of graduating high school, if they do graduate high school, the patterning is already set to not be able to climb the fences to get to the highest levels of academia. There's another issue. In the highest levels of academia, there's not enough recognition of the tapestry, the rich tapestry of portfolio of mentors or mentees who happen to be underrepresented minorities who are already in the system, such that manuscripts and grants become the main form through which people are viewed as being successful or not successful. One might want to argue that just like socioeconomic status that has so many different components to it, the academic tapestry has many different components to it. And as an underrepresented minority individual, I might argue that the responsibilities and pressures placed upon one to be involved in a multitude of activities that relate to mentoring up, mentoring down, and in multiple different directions need to be more taken into account as one climbs the academic ranks. The AHA is involved in big science, big data, in an effort to promote and understand better the relationship between population science and molecular work. And as such, the AHA announced last year the CVD Phenome Genome Project, which is, I think, a tremendous opportunity for health disparities research, which joins Boston University with the University of Mississippi and their associated cohort studies, the Framingham Heart Study, which has given us so much information about heart health, and the Jackson Heart Study, which is a more recent study of all African Americans living in Jackson, Mississippi, one of the poorest and most disadvantaged places related to health in the United States. Joining forces between these two cohorts is intended to provide unprecedented new data and new information to inform therapies, and more so how you might implement therapies or implement change or focus on how individuals and populations might adhere to health messages, as well as behavior, change their behavior to achieve better cardiovascular health, and also to narrow the gap in life expectancy between blacks and whites. I'd like to end by again noting that, you know, there does, although there's been significant gains in life expectancy across all race ethnic groups, the gap still remains. The gap has narrowed, but the gap still remains. And that gap is a gap that's not only going to be narrowed by basic science, it is going to be narrowed by linking chains between basic science, psychological stress, population-based research, all the things that go into socioeconomic status comprehensively, and actually new technologies such as the utilization of social media to change the trajectory of risk, and also to eliminate disparities.